Our topic is God, justice, and violence or nonviolence. And when we talk about religion, and when we talk in particular also about violence and relationship between religion and violence, often our personal stories inform where we come from. We see things from a particular angle. And so what I thought I would do today is I would give you a bit of my story with religion and violence. Then I'll take you to what I consider to be the key fundamental Christian convictions that give foundation for the claim that Christian faith is fundamentally nonviolent. And then ask the question, but why is it that we experience it in many places to be very different than nonviolent? And then I'll conclude returning back to something more personal. So that's our plan for this evening. I was born in former Yugoslavia in a town of Osijek, in a part of it that was built as a fortress. And it was built as a fortress at the end of 17th century, so that the Turks who have been defeated, Muslim Turks who have been defeated at the gates of Vienna and were retreating back, would not be able to come back, right? And so it was a fortress, a series of fortresses. And in one of these, I was born, and another one about 70 miles east, I used to place a huge fortress with the four levels of the tunnels that went miles and miles, and you could go and get lost there, and we had a great time at skids with huge moats and stuff like that, you know, all built in order to protect the Christian Europe from the murderous Muslim Turks, right? That's kind of one experience. The second experience was as World War II was fairly violent in my part of the world, and especially now saw two different types of Christians pretty severely at war with one another. The Catholic Croatians and the Orthodox Greek, or it was actually Serbian Orthodox Serbians. And their Christian faith very much was implicated in what was a very bloody portion of the history of my country. Then immediately after the war, there's another quasi-religion, a religion that responded or that reacted to this religious, in part to this religious violence, which was communism. I was born in the communist Yugoslavia. Communists immediately after World War II decided they wanted to make an end to violent religion, and persecutions were very severe. In fact, my father was also took part in one of the death marches, and it's actually during a death march, and then which he survived. In his group, 1,000 started and 300 made it through the death march. And then he worked in a labor camp. And there, in the midst of what he described as hell, he discovered that God is love. Now, maybe next time when I come here, I can tell you the story of this discovery, how you can discover that God is love in the midst of hell. He did. And he shaped my own thinking about the relationship between Christian faith and violence. Imagine this, in the midst of extraordinary pressure and violence, here this tender plant of faith in the God who is love emerges in his own heart. Some people say, people talk about my father finding God, and he always talked about it as God found him. He would have never found God in those kinds of circumstances. It was in some ways the other way around. And then there's a fourth, I think, fifth experience, and this was my saintly nanny. It was a woman whose husband was killed in that war between Croats and Serbs. She had no place to live, and we had two rooms in which in one she could sleep together with kids who she was taking care of. And she was the angel of my childhood. She was one of those always joyful Christians who went through day singing, and more significant for me was that she was utterly non-judgmental. Often you encounter Christians that are with their prim noses looking to find fault with anything they can find fault, and then zap you because you're breaking some terrible law of God. And none of this happened with her. Immense amount of patience and attention to us as a children, to me in particular, and at the same time a kind of sense not so much of angry reaction to infraction, but sense of sadness that something that was good was not done, that something that was good was missed. Now, I'm telling you all this because as I was growing up, one of the stories in the Bible that was really significant for me was the story of the prodigal son. Here we've got also a guy who squandered everything and is returning to his dad. And even before he comes and apologizes, his father embraces him. Obviously, there is sadness but no judgment. There is acceptance of this person, and that for me became a paradigm for what Christian faith is about. And so when I think about God, I often have in mind the image of the father in the story of the prodigal son, but this father in the story of the prodigal son bears the face of my nanny. And she was the old, if you've seen Russian babushkas with scarves, that's who she was. She was about 60 when she was taking care of me. Amazing human being. More importantly, amazing Christian. So if you think of these kinds of experiences, you see on the one hand incredible beauty of the faith that is understood as this unconditional love. On the other hand, you have experiences, as was the case during the Second World War, and as is the case in many parts of the world today and was throughout history, where Christian faith is employed to legitimize violence. It's these two experiences somehow that we have to put together and explain why is this happening. But before I come to the explanation of why Christian faith sometimes, as I would say, seriously malfunctions and legitimizes violence, let me just give you a set of how I have come to understand the Christian faith. And what I'll give you is kind of a series of statements that for me serve almost like the skeleton around which everything else hangs in the Christian faith. They are the most fundamental convictions of the Christian faith. And I'll start from the kind of backwards and working myself to the most central one. First, that I want to mention is that, and what's the signature for the Christian faith, is the command to love the enemy. It's not the command simply to love the neighbor. It is explicitly a command to love an enemy. That, in a sense, is revolutionary, and that tells you already where the Christian faith as a whole is going to be if that is one of its fundamental claims. And indeed, it's very interesting if you look through the history of Christian faith. Obviously, when Christianity became a dominant religion, the question then became, well, what's the relationship between the state and state action and the Christian faith? What happens when you're under attack by an enemy? Can you justify war at all? And the most interesting thing is that for the most part, the war, if it was justified, and for many years and centuries, actually, Christians were prohibited to be active soldiers. When the war was allowed, it was allowed as, it was only allowed if it could be shown it is an instance of the love of enemy. You couldn't just wage war to defend yourself. You couldn't even just wage war to defend a third party. And one may debate whether that's the right thing or not. You had to also wage war in a way that takes the good of the one who is attacking you into consideration. Or even stronger, to pursue in the war itself or in violent action the good of the one against whom your action is directed. Now, you may scratch your head and ask yourself whether that's at all possible, but the fact that that was what was required indicates how seriously the idea of the love of enemy was taken. Now, why was the idea, sometimes I put it this way, you take away love of enemy from Christian faith, you un-Christian the Christian faith. Take away love of enemy from Christian faith, you un-Christian the Christian faith. And the reason for that, I think, is the following. Because the love of enemy follows immediately upon, and it's a consequence of, another fundamental conviction of the Christian faith, namely that God came to save and to justify the ungodly. In other words, it's not that you have to become a certain kind of a person, and then God looks at you and evaluates, and God says, okay, now you're fine, you can come. But rather, it's the action of God is the one who loves the sinner and justifies, makes just the one who is not just. Again, so you see, in fact, then, that God here is portrayed as the one who loves the enemy. We all, in some ways, are the ones who do not deserve love of God, but God nonetheless loves, creates. It's one of the most beautiful things in the Christian faith. Martin Luther writes at one point, love of God doesn't find something that's lovable and loves, but love of God creates out of something that's not lovable to be something that is lovable. Right? So you've got this love of enemy, God's love of all human beings, including the ungodly, and then you have also the idea of God dying on the cross for the salvation of the world. God taking upon God's self the sin of the world so that we, humanity, can be freed from the guilt of sin. Again, kind of radically nonviolent action. We can talk about implications of this, in what ways critiques can be leveled against Christian faith just on this count, but maybe that will be something for our discussion. And then finally, you have the idea that God not just loves human beings. Because if you simply say that God loves human beings, it may be that God at some point turns and decides that God is not going to love any more human beings. It could be then that God's love can be seen as in some sense conditional, conditioned upon the kinds of behavior that we manifest. But the Christian faith claims makes us stronger. Wait, let me take my jacket off. These are very important issues. And they need sleeves rolled up. So the claim of the Christian faith is not simply that God loves. Claim of the Christian faith is that God is love. And there's a difference. If God is love, then it cannot be under any circumstances the case that God does not love. God cannot not love. If you ask me what God can do, here's what God can do. God cannot not love. Because fundamentally, that is the character of God. And Christian faith expresses that in the idea that God is the Holy Trinity. From the eternity to eternity, God is the communion of love. When God creates out of love. When God redeems out of love. When God brings the world to completion, God does that out of love. And importantly, because God is love, unconditional love. Now that, I think, is skeleton of the Christian faith. God is love. God saves, creates out of love. God redeems out of love. God embraces the ungodly, and God commands us to emulate God, which is to say, to love the enemy. So you see why I said earlier that you take away the love of enemy, you unchristian the Christian faith, that all of these convictions, they hang together, and around them is built the entire edifice of the Christian faith. Now, that sounds really nice. I hope it sounds nice to you. It sounds very nice to me, and that's the main reason why I'm a Christian. That sounds all very nice, but if you look the history through the history of the Christian faith, of Christianity, you will see a long and large dark blotches. Christian history that's marred by religious violence, or at least violence of Christians. So how do we make this sense between the, how do we put together this claim that Christian faith is the religion of unconditional love, thank you, and the reality of Christian history in which not just unconditional love, but no love has been shown in many cases, but rather something very much opposite to love. First, let's note one distinction that I think is very important to make when we talk about religion and violence. And that is the distinction between whether religion is the primary motivation for violence or whether religion functions as a legitimizing force or ideology for violence, whether it motivates primarily violence or simply legitimizes it. Now, famous political philosopher, probably one of the most influential ones in the Western tradition, Thomas Hobbes, in his book Leviathan, he identified three main reasons for conflict between people. And I think he's done as good of a job as you can do. And basically said there are three reasons why people fight. They fight for gain, they fight for safety, and they fight for honor or reputation. And if you look throughout the history, these have been the main causes of violence. Notice that he didn't mention religion so much. Maybe you can put religion under the larger rubric of reputation or something like honor, right? But religion historically, in fact, and even presently, has not been significant independent source of motivation for violence. Of course, there have been religious wars, but if you look at the religious wars carefully also, you see that suddenly there are multiple motives, economic, political, cultural, and so forth, and religion is one additional motive to among many. So I think it's important then to note that very often when religion has played a role, it has played what might be described not so much primary motivating role, but legitimizing role. That is to say, people got involved in violence for various reasons, let's say gain or security, and then you needed support of religion to legitimize what you've decided to do in any case. Now, that too is a serious matter. If religion, if Christian faith legitimizes violence, it contributes to it, right? And so the question then becomes, why, under what circumstances does religion, does Christian faith, other religions as well, good case can be made also for Buddhism in the same regard. Under what conditions does Christian faith become legitimizing force for violence? And here I would recommend to all of you to read a little book that has been written by a rather well-known sociologist by the name of David Martin. And the title of this book is Does Christianity Cause War? He builds then on two traditions of thinking about the role of religion in kind of public affairs. And that is the traditions that come from Kant, Immanuel Kant, philosopher, and Thomas Hobbes. Now, Thomas Hobbes thought that a way in which religion functions in kind of social and political settings is that the rulers use religious convictions in order to make their subjects more malleable and so that they can guide them toward the ends that they desire for them. So religion ends up being tool in political, in the hands of politicians, right? So that's one tradition. The second tradition was what Kant said. Kant said that religion often serves to mark the identities of peoples. It's almost like functions like a language, or sometimes you can say it functions almost like a flag. We are the ones who belong to this religious group. I'll give you an example from my own country. During the war in former Yugoslavia, recent war, there are many wars there. We kind of like to fight. Hope we'll learn something, and we won't do it as much. But during the recent war, earlier as well, you could see photos of Serbian fighters sitting, for instance, on a tank and flashing this sign. Now, this is not a kind of a botched victory sign with thumbs sticking out too much rather than something like this. This is actually a sign, a Christian sign. These three fingers represent the Holy Trinity. These two fingers represent the two natures of Christ. And when Orthodox people cross themselves, they don't cross themselves like barbarian Westerners with a hand like this, you know. They cross themselves with three fingers together representing the Holy Trinity, two natures of Christ, and then making the sign of the cross, right? You can see here almost the entirety of the Christian faith expressed in this sign, right? Or this sign, right? But for a fighter on the tank, it means none of this. The only thing this means, we are the Serbians. We are the Orthodox. We belong to this group. So it becomes a pure marker of identity. Now, David Martin has then argued, religion, Christian faith also, becomes violent when it turns into marker of identity and when it aligns itself with the political power, either power that strives to become dominant or the power that is dominant. Combine identity with political power and mix in the religion, and religion will then participate in the struggles for power that mark political life. Then religion becomes violent. That is the most common reason why a very peaceful religion in its very nature can turn into a violent religion. I'll give you one more example from not of the Christian faith, similar kind of dynamic. Buddhism has a reputation, I think deservedly, to be a very peaceful religion, as peaceful as any that come, maybe comparable to Christian faith. It's peaceful religion. We can discuss other aspects of Buddhism, but you have cases in Myanmar, now in Sri Lanka, where Buddhism is very much involved in violent action, a phenomenon of a monk with weapons. Now, that kind of phenomenon needs somehow the explanation because it cannot draw explanation from the teaching of Buddha. And the explanation is very simple. In Sri Lanka, the issue was that Sinhalese culture had to be protected, which was connected closely to Buddhism. And monks, when they started protecting Sinhalese culture, seeing themselves as guardian of Sinhalese culture, then gradually transformed the entire religion to become legitimate to involve in violent actions. So you see again, identity, politics, and religion mixed in, it becomes then a tool and therefore becomes violent. I said earlier, I'm a Christian because I believe that God is love. For me, the central question is not so much whether God exists. Now, you might be surprised when I say that. But what is the nature of God? Recently, I've heard that Friedrich Buechner, you're from Buechner, in one of his stories, or it was one of his sermons, he asked his readers or his listeners to imagine one thing, especially those who are kind of atheists. Imagine, for instance, one day, up on the top of the sky, throughout the entire sky, there appear big letters. It says, "I exist, God." And at first you think clouds or something has happened. No, but it stays there. And first everybody's surprised. They think, what's happening? Do you look whether it's going to disappear? No, it's not disappearing. I exist, God, right? You have indisputable proof that God exists. After a week, you look, is it still going to be there? Still there. After a month, it's still there. And pretty soon, it becomes normalcy. That up there becomes a cloud. And you continue to live the way you've lived, even though it says up there for everybody to see, I, namely God, do exist. Fundamental question is not whether God exists, but who is God, and what is your relationship, what is my relationship to God? Do I give primary allegiance to God? You can put it this way. If you don't love God with above all things, you really do not believe in God. If you don't think God is the one to be loved above all things, you may think that you believe in God, but you actually believe in something else. So the fundamental question before which we stand, I think, is this. Who is this God, and what is my relationship to God? When I claim that God is love, this is what some people have described as a self-involving statement. I cannot say God is love without that having implications for the way in which I am going to conduct my life, the way in which I am going to perceive the entire world. I will see then the world as a gift of God to me. I will relate to this world before me in a different way. Suddenly the entirety of reality will come new and different to me. I want to invite you to consider this when you think about relationship between God and violence. Not God's existence, not the uses we make of God, but whether this God who is love is in fact the object of our ultimate concern. Once God becomes the object of our, that kind of God becomes object of our ultimate concern, Christian faith becomes a source of flourishing, source of love, rather than undermining our lives and sowing death in its trail. Thank you very much.
Dr. Volf, now we'll go into a sort of interview. I'll ask you a few questions, and after that we'll open it up to the audience to ask some questions. Don't forget that you can text in some questions. I'll be looking to my phone for your questions.
Are you going to be texting these questions here behind my back?
That's right.
And everybody's going to see, and I'm not? Something not quite right, but no.
So
I see you snickering. What? Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. So you talked about the nature of God being love. I wanted to ask you a question about that, where we see some maybe evidence that God isn't so loving, or it seems in his actions that he's not so loving. So let me give you a little setup, then ask my question. So, you know, there are places in the Bible where God commands his people to kill, even to annihilate an entire people group, men, women, children, animals, to demolish an entire city. So you see that in the Old Testament. And then you have this picture in the New Testament of Jesus being a humble servant who suffers on behalf of others. But then you have in the last book of the Bible, Jesus coming back on a horse with a sword. Is he coming back to take vengeance or something? And he engages in battle with his enemies. And finally, we have a God who at the end of history brings everyone before him and judges people by their actions. And then the traditional conception of Christianity, sends some people to suffer in hell. So if God is love, how do you account for these sort of things that have been revealed to us in the Bible?
Those are great questions. How much time do we have?
We have 20 minutes for this portion.
It's a semester work worth of explanations that are necessary for this. I think it's important to keep in mind, what I've suggested, what I've sketched, is what I've described as a kind of narrative skeleton of the Christian faith, and then that whatever we find in the Bible has in some ways been garnered from, the skeleton has been garnered from what we find in the Bible, but on the other hand, it has to be also read, the entire Bible has to be read also in the light of that. For instance, the entire Bible, I think, has to be read in the light of the appearance of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ said, it was said to the old, to the people of the old, but I say unto you. So there's a kind of a shift that occurs with the coming of Christ. And certainly from the perspective of Christ and revelation in Christ, the wiping out of entire populations cannot be justified. When I talk to Muslims about the question of violence, of course, these days Muslim God has the reputation of being the most violent deity. But with Muslims, when I talk to Muslims, they always say, I've heard two or three times, especially reading the book of Joshua, where God says not only to kill soldiers, not only women, but children, not only children, but all the livestock. And so the question is, what has livestock done to God?
Yeah,
that God demands, right? the killing of even the livestock. And I think the response is that the Christian faith reads these texts in the light of revelation in Jesus Christ, and that there is a progressive revelation which we need to assume. So I think my reading of the Christian story is you read it from the very heart of the story, and then see the developments up to it through that. Now,
okay.
That question doesn't quite answer the last part of
That's
it
right,
because
yeah.
you pointed me to the very beginning and then also to the very end, which is the story of Jesus Christ coming on the white horse.
That's right.
And the question then becomes, well, how do we interpret this? Is the Christ on the cross a different Christ than the Christ that comes in the second coming? Or should we read the coming of Christ as described in the book of Revelation as, if you want, symbolic representation of the fact that if you are to have a world of love, well, dirty shoes have to stay out. you can have world of love, but have a non-love in the midst of the world of love. Mm-hmm. So the creation of the world of love in some sense presumes either overcoming of all non-love or exclusion of that which is not, loving from that world. And so the Christian tradition has always thought then therefore of the kind of ultimate separation. There has been a long tradition also, of course, of hope that the transformation is going to occur. And at the same time, I think many, many great theologians have thought that even for those who accept something like the dual destiny and the existence of hell, a number of even evangelical theologians do not go that route. Typical example is, for instance, John Stott, mm-hmm. a very famous Mr. Evangelical who interprets those texts differently. But even when theologians have thought, Christians have thought that there is an existence of hell, they somehow had to square that with the existence of love of God, mm-hmm. and that being an expression of the love of God. So you see how much pressure the claim that God is love exerts. And we have to then ask ourselves to what extent whatever we say is compatible with the love of God as described in Jesus Christ. Not some kind of abstract love, but that kind of love as described, as manifest in the story of Jesus Christ.
Couldn't God, bring in those people, transform them or something, transform them with his love rather than judge them?
Well, God is doing the transforming.
Okay.
think of it this way. No matter what God does to you, God can't make you to be the creature of love. Mm. Imagine God placing you into the best of all possible circumstances. And you might think if you were placed in the best of all possible circumstances, you may just kind of respond to the best of all circumstances in appropriate way to this best of all circumstances. And yet we know that you have to see that these circumstances are the best before you can actually respond in that way. This is what happened with Adam and Eve. Of course, I'm describing the situation. You can be unhappy in paradise. Nobody can make you happy by putting you in a paradise. The happiness comes both from the circumstances and from within, when the circumstances and the self and reaction of the self to circumstances meet and are at one. And I think this is the reason why heaven cannot be imposed. Heaven must be embraced, internal, from within, right? And that's where the human will plays a role. That's where kind of the joy that comes from within is significant. You can't enforce joy. You can't force love either. All of these things, because we are creatures of freedom, have to come from within, and therefore, I think there's a possibility of us going otherwise than where God is nudging us to go.
Thank you. And I have another question. This one has less to do with God's actions, more to do with the actions of his followers or the mindset. So we have many people embracing a sort of religious exclusivism, where their way is right and any other view on religion is not right. I'm wondering if this can tend towards violence, if this promotes violence. The thinking might go like this: my religion's right, yours is wrong. We're in this sort of cosmic war, and God's on my side, not on yours. And so maybe violence against you is justified. Right, so we're bringing, say we're bringing about God's kingdom or something. If people didn't have this mindset of exclusivism that I'm right, you're wrong, wouldn't things be better? Wouldn't there be less religious conflict?
Yeah, there are a number of things that you mentioned. Not just the claim that my convictions are correct and yours aren't, or somebody else's aren't, but also that I somehow have responsibility to force you to embrace my own convictions. I think you can very easily show that this is actually those are two options to which to go, and actually they're embodied in American history at the very beginning of America. In Massachusetts Bay, you have a face-off between two traditions that are of exclusivism, not non-exclusivist and exclusive, but two traditions of exclusivism. One was John Winthrop, and the other one was Roger Williams. John Winthrop and Roger Williams were both equally exclusivistic. If you were to bet, and you could finally measure exclusivism, I bet that maybe Roger Williams's exclusivism might be even sturdier than John Winthrop's, right? As exclusivism. But John Winthrop thought that that God demanded, that the truth about God was that God demanded that the state enforces obedience to God's law so that God can bless the new colony, it can become the city set on the hill. State's role in enforcing God's commandment was fundamental to his exclusivist conception. Now, Roger Williams thought exactly opposite of him. He thought that it stinks in God's nostrils if people are forced to obey God's laws by force. Not because Roger Williams was less exclusivistic. This was also an exclusivistic claim.
Okay, so, right? So they're kind of separate issues.
These are two separate distinct issues, so that you can be actually religious exclusivist, and just because you're a religious exclusivist, advocate tolerance toward others and advocate political pluralism. I make this argument in my new book, Flourishing, Why We Need Religion in a Globalized World. Just that argument, I have a whole section on religious exclusivism and political pluralism. Why one can be religious exclusivist and advocate political pluralism.
Okay, thank you. So it's sort of like I might think someone's wrong about something. I hold a position, they hold the contrary, but I can live in peace with them, right?
Or you can put it this way. Might it be your strong exclusivist conviction that religion needs to be embraced freely, that Christian faith needs to be embraced freely? I think that's a good candidate for a fundamental Christian conviction. I can't force anybody to embrace Christian faith. Nature of Christian faith is such that I need to respect the freedom of person either to reject or to embrace it. Second, so that's freedom of religion, I think, which can be a result of my strongly held convictions. Second, equality of all human beings. This doesn't need to be introduced into Christian faith somehow from outside. God created all human beings equal. Right? This is a fundamental conviction. You can see it throughout certainly New Testament. You can see it also in some other faiths as well, the fundamental equality of all human beings. If you have these two things, freedom of religion and equality, you're going to have something like political pluralism. You won't have imposition of religion religious rules, even if you have an exclusivistic faith.
Thank you. My next question, I think, will bring us back to the Bible, back to an account in the Bible that's central, and that's of the cross. So the story goes, as I'm sure you know, that Jesus was, you know, placed on the cross according to the Father's will. So the Father condemned his Son to death on a cross, and not for the Son's sins, but for the sins of other people. So a couple of things. Isn't this sort of a barbaric view of the reaction to wrongdoing, that it requires blood? Violent aspect of Christianity. And second, is it just for God to punish his Son for the sins that other people have committed?
Again, all fantastic questions, but huge, and demanding long explanations. I'll put it very simply. If you think of what's happening on the cross as involving three parties, which is, I think, how you describe the objection. One party is the Father, the second party is the Son, and the third party is the humanity.
Right, yeah.
Right? If you have these three parties that are involved, then what you have said follows. Then God, the Father, one, is punishing somebody else for the third party's transgression. What kind of transaction is that? But the basic problem with this position is that actually you don't have three parties. You have actually split God into two. And you have assumed as if there were two gods that are involved. One God angry and the other one God willing to take the anger, bear the anger. But there aren't two gods. There is only one God. And the unity of Father and the Son is the unity of, now I have to go into doctrine of the Trinity right here, because people, the theologians, have used the term. It's not exactly the most precise, but I think it will serve purposes. They talk about numerical identity of God's substance. Numerical identity of God's substance, which means to say Father and the Son are numerically one. It's not that you count the persons of a Trinity and then put them next to the chairs. Now we added another chair here, and there are three of us sitting together, and we say, well, let's see, what do we do with these guys down there? They are slaughtering each other. They're sinful. We need to redeem them. Okay, now because I'm the boss, I'm going to punish you.
I'll go, yeah.
Yeah, and the other one says, okay, fine, I agree with you, and we have some kind of an agreement or something of that sort, right? That will be three parties involved. But you cannot imagine that there's a singleness of the will, complete alignment of wills in divine nature, and therefore it's not a transfer. It actually is God taking the sin of the world upon God's own self.
Okay.
God carrying, the Lamb of God that carries the sin of the world is God carrying the sin of the world. And this carrying of the sin is precisely because of this extraordinary love of God toward humanity. And sin is a serious business in the sense that it cuts us off from the very source of life. And because it cuts us off, it's not an arbitrary punishment. It's not a kind of vengeful God or parent who's been completely annoyed that the kid's misbehaving, and then
demand blood, right?
Overreacts, right? And then decides, then kind of repents afterwards. So what did I do? You know, why did I overreact? You know, it's kind of father gone out of control, right? But rather, it's at the very nature of the separation of the self from God is the separation of the one who is the very foundation of our lives. Again, we are not in a situation as the Father and the Son in a relationship, earthly relationship, might be, because they're two independent creatures, right? Whereas every single breath I take is the breath given to me by God. Every single atom of my body is the atom carried in existence by God. And so the relationship between the two is different.
I really want to ask a follow-up question, but I think I'll move on. Maybe I can ask it and then not give you a chance to answer.
Sounds good too. You know.
I'm not sure that you responded to the claim about how it's just for one person to take on the sins of another. How does that?
Yeah, no,
I can go.
It's
in 30 seconds.
In 30 seconds is also. I think generally I have advocated what some people have described as inclusive substitution.
Okay.
Not exclusive substitution. It's not so much somebody dies instead of me, but actually on the cross, that's how the cross is portrayed in the biblical text, is actually I die in Christ's death.
Okay.
Right? Yeah. So Apostle Paul says in one point, one person died. Now, you would expect, if it was exclusive substitution, to follow, therefore nobody needs to die. Mm-hmm. But he says, and therefore all have died. Mm. So in Christ, you have it's almost like how Christians think of baptism. You die and you're raised again. So in Christ's death, we die with Christ, and in Christ's resurrection, we are raised to a new life. You don't have, the third party in the strict sense of the term, so that somehow what Christ has done then kind of applies to you. But rather, in Christ, you undergo that. There is an identification between self and Christ in the very act of dying and rising to new life.
Thank you. Final question, and then we'll get to the audience Q&A. So we've seen in the news, not in this country really, but stories of Christians in other countries being victims of violence, and that's occurred throughout history. How should Christians respond to violence perpetrated against them? Gotcha.
No. Well, you know, you're talking to a person who has been jailed because of the Christian faith, who's been beaten because of the Christian faith. My father has been jailed. Many of my friends have been jailed, have been, you describe, persecuted. I've been interrogated for months because of the Christian faith. I think Christ has warned us to expect persecution.
Sure.
And has called us to love and bless those who persecute us. That doesn't mean that we shouldn't work toward environments in which there shouldn't be any persecution. But if we find ourselves in situations of persecution, we're called to take up our cross and follow Christ.
Thank you. Very good. Thank you. We'll move to the Q&A at this point. What do you say to women like me? It's coming from the audience, who have felt more love, practically speaking, from the feminist movements of the past 100 years than from God.
Well, I think it's one thing to feel the love from God, and it's another thing for that love to be actually there. I think God has been co-opted for the purposes, among other things, of oppressing women, of keeping women down, of blaming women for varieties of things, including their gullible nature and of bringing the sin into the world. I don't think that any of this corresponds, in fact, to the very character of the Christian faith. I think Jesus was, for his time, affirming the radical equality of human beings, and therefore also of genders. And I cannot imagine the unconditionally loving God to think that one half of the human race is somehow more sinful and inferior to the other half of the human race. In other words, I can put it this way, I think that God affirms radical equality of women and men. The fact that we needed to be, Christians needed to be reminded of the legacy that is within Christian faith and that was fundamentally affirmant at the beginning is a deeply troubling thing. It's the same kind of history as the history of violence that Christian faith has participated in. Often it happens when we're unable, unwilling to distinguish between Christian faith and the culture which we inhabit. Those kinds of distinctions are sometimes very hard to make, and they require a good deal of discernment. I've never had the sense, though, that I cannot learn something from outside of the Christian faith. I never thought of Christian faith as, or Christians, and how Christians understand faith as something that's complete and nothing can be improved in the way in which we understand our faith. Christian theologians early on thought of Christ as being source of all wisdom, so that the ancient philosophers actually were wise through the wisdom which was in Christ without even knowing Christ. You can be wise by the wisdom, through the wisdom of God, without knowing Christ, without embracing Christ. You can do good without necessarily believing in God and still do that good because of God. In fact, everything that you do, if you're a Christian, you do because of God. So the wisdom can be found elsewhere, and there's also reverse prophetism, a prophetism directed against the church. And I think we have to be ready for that. And I think the attitude of humility, of a sense that Christ is the wisdom that enlightens everyone, but that it doesn't, that doesn't mean that I have the wisdom that enlightens everyone. It doesn't mean that I am completely enlightened either, that there's nothing that I can learn from the outside. This kind of a learning while still holding on to fundamental convictions about Christ, I think that's a fundamental aspect of Christian faith.
Sorry, I'm trying.
Yeah, you're trying to figure out decent and undecent questions.
The technology is tweaking on me here, but okay, so is there a question from the audience?
Hi. Is this on?
Yeah, that doesn't matter.
Yes, it's on.
Okay. So we do have a duty to love our enemies. Sure. It seems to me perfectly consistent with that we can also defend ourselves from them. So do you agree with that? And if so, how would you think that we can take this insight and apply it to the situation of the Muslim immigrants in Europe who have killed Europeans and done other bad things to them recently?
Yeah, I certainly agree with you that we can love our enemies and we can defend ourselves from them. I think we can love our children and discipline our children. Right? There are many things that out of love can be done. I think it's first and foremost, it's important whatever action we undertake, that we can plausibly justify to ourselves, if we're Christians, that we are doing it also out of love for the enemy. Obviously, we do it because we want to protect third parties. Sometimes we want to protect also ourselves. So self-defense is a slightly different issue. So I think that's quite acceptable and possible. What is the conclusion that we draw from this? Do we bomb them? Do we wipe them out? My response would be you contain, right? There are multiple ways in which we can contain. I mean, an example could be also something like capital punishment, slightly different, but even harder case, I guess, in some ways. I'm a staunch opponent of capital punishment. I think it's a radically unchristian thing to do. If we need to contain the person who is doing the harm, we can contain, if possible, we need to contain that person without killing that person. To kill a person means to take the opportunity away from that person to repent, to transform their own lives. The gospel is there and the good news is there precisely as a message of the possibility of transformation. I am put differently. radically opposed to retributive justice. I think Christ is the end of retribution. It doesn't mean that Christ is the end of any form of punishment. It doesn't mean that Christ is the end of working toward protection of communities, of self, and so forth. But Christ is the end of taking away of lives, even lives of those who are guilty. By the way, I'll sound too radical. By the way, that's what I think, that there may be circumstances in which Christians could be allowed to take a life of another person. There may be such circumstances, right? But they cannot be circumstances that somebody imposes upon you. So, for instance, if you're a soldier and you oblige yourself by the very fact of being a soldier to kill upon command of your superior, for this situation is, from Christian standpoint, completely unacceptable. I cannot, without discrimination, take another life of another person on command from somebody else. That seems to me a violation of fundamental principles of Christian morality.
There are a lot of questions on people who have never heard the gospel and hell. So here's one that was pretty eloquent. You implied that all humans have the free will to choose God, but this seems untrue. There have been billions of people throughout history who haven't had a good chance or any chance at all to adopt Christianity. There are roughly 1 billion of these people in India right now who simply haven't heard about Christianity. In what way is sending these people who have failed to adopt Christianity through no fault of their own to hell for all eternity an expression of love? In many ways, it seems like God predestined them for eternal suffering, regardless of their actions.
Yeah, I tend not to think, I don't think that, I'll put it this way. I hope the hell is going to be empty. So I don't expect billions upon billions of people ending up in eternal suffering. That seems to be incompatible with the character of God. It seems to me also not necessary from the statements that you find in biblical text in the New Testament. In fact, there's not a single person that is imagined in hell. It's certainly not in eternal suffering. And we have to ask ourselves, why is that? So from my perspective, I do not think that eternal suffering is the faith of majority of humanity. And even if there is a separation from God, I do not think that it entails eternal suffering. I am the universalist in hope, but not as a matter of principle. I can imagine resistance to the love of God, but a hell as a torture chamber next to hell, which heaven, which is a site of glorious enjoyment, I find impossible to imagine. I find it impossible to imagine how the saints in glory would not be overcome with sadness over the suffering of those who aren't there. And therefore, I do not believe in eternal suffering. If you want to read something from a more evangelical standpoint, something of that sort, that position, John Stott is probably as good as anyone else on this, where he argues that there isn't eternal hell understood as eternal suffering.
Does globalization facilitate more or less religious violence, in your view?
I think it goes both ways in some way, in certain sense, by bringing globalization, because it intertwines people, destabilizes kind of social settings and cultural settings in which they find themselves, creates as a counter-reaction, certain forms of fundamentalism, and then contributes to religious violence. On the other hand, at the same time, by pluralizing the environments in which we find ourselves, it creates situations in which no single religion can dominate, or our religion can dominate the public space, and therefore contributes to the possibility of there being much more pluralistic political space, and therefore less religious violence. Both currents are present. Long term, I'm hoping that it's going to turn more toward the peaceful situation. Short term, reactions are certainly there, and globalization has also contributed to tensions between people, therefore participation of religion in those tensions.
I have a question here. It's working now. As someone so deeply and radically shaped by the Christian faith, do you find it difficult to be deep friends with people who are not Christians? How do you prevent yourself from living in a sort of Christian ghetto? Not my words.
I don't find it difficult to be friends with non-Christians. I don't find it, for instance, difficult to read appreciatively non-Christian authors. I've said many times that some of my most stimulating experiences, and I'll put it this way, almost humanly and spiritually most enlightening experiences, was a year that I've spent reading in the evenings Nietzsche's writings. I went through almost all of Nietzsche's writings and read through. You can find the more radical critic of the Christian faith, you can find the more angry critic of the Christian faith, but you can't also find the smarter critic of the Christian faith than is Nietzsche. I kind of like him in a strange way. You know, it's almost like a weird cousin that you have, right? and you kind of appreciate him, but he's off. There's no question about it, right? Off at the same time, profoundly important in your life and significant in shape with all the disagreements that are there. I have friends, very close friends, who are Muslims. We talk all the time, and I find that my relationship to them has not compromised my faith. It strengthened my faith. So I think if one is secure enough in one's own faith, And if one doesn't hold it so tightly that if you see a little crack coming, that you feel it's going to burst, everything's going to burst and fall apart, right? I think if you think of it that the doubt, that uncertainty is a structural element, moment of faith itself. Once you recognize this, then you can see that kind of the skeleton, the structure can be there, but many things can shift and change without calling things into question. Indeed, that's how one has to think of the Christian faith, because it's a living thing, right? We live with our Christian faith. Our Christian faith develops as we develop. You know, I sometimes put it this way, and I've learned many things from non-Christians. This is also what I've learned from a non-Christian. He said, if you read the same text, sacred text, twice and it means the same thing, you haven't read it rightly. Now, you might want to invert that and say, if you read it and they mean two different things, you should be really worried, right? Because it's supposed to be true, right? But, and in some ways it's also, that's also correct, right? The text is saying the same thing, but for the text to say the same thing to you that it's saying yesterday, it must be understood slightly differently today because you're different today. You are a river that is changing. And the text, biblical text, is a live text. Christian faith is a live thing, not a dead thing. not a set of laws or rules that you apply simply. It's living and breathing, and that's why Christians believe in the Holy Spirit, right? The Holy Spirit who speaks through those texts to us today, not in opposition to what was then, but in the continuity, in the living continuity with what was before. Once you start understanding faith in that supple way, then you can be learning from all sorts of sources, and that reinforcing the integrity of your faith rather than undermining.
All right, thank you for the questions. I'm going to ask one last question to cap the Q&A time, and then we'll have Jonathan Ramos close us. So we've talked a lot about violence, religion, living in a pluralistic society, ordering one's life according to religious tenets, living under the knowledge of God's love. But what exactly is the goal of all of this, of the human life? What's a good life for human beings? And is Christianity somehow connected to that?
So I think for me, Jesus Christ is the key to humanity. It's key to what it means to be human, and it's key to becoming fully human. And Jesus Christ in some ways is described in the New Testament as the embodiment of the kingdom of God. And when the Apostle Paul defines the kingdom of God, he tells you in one point place in Romans 14 what the kingdom of God is not and what the kingdom of God is. And then he says, kingdom of God is not, what isn't it? Remember? Food and drink. It isn't, your ordinary stuff, that you, your clothes, whatever we spend most of our lives worrying about, right? How you look when you when you get up, and how it's going to, your image during the day, how you dress, all that kind of stuff, right? Cars you drive and not drive, and that's not what the kingdom of God. And then he says, what is the kingdom of God? Kingdom of God is righteousness and peace and joy. Now, what is righteousness? Righteousness is acting in the right way in the world. Peace is life going well for you, the circumstances of life being such that they're conducive to your life as a human being in the community. And joy has to do with emotions. Life feeling, right? So kingdom of God has to do with your actions and character, with circumstances of your life, and with your emotions. All three combined together, they express the flourishing life, and all of them are embodied in the life and death and ascension and glorification of Christ.
Thank you. Let's thank our speaker.
For more information about the Veritas Forum, including additional recordings and a calendar of upcoming events, please visit our website at veritas.org.